almost 200 years, from 1757 to 1947, Great Britain ruled impassively over India and one quarter of the land surface of the earth. British rule seemed to many to be God-sent and immutable. What began as a purely business venture of the East India Company, in time became the British Raj of India. Queen Victoria called India the jewel in the crown of the empire. Indeed, India was known the world over as a great civilization whose name was synonymous with sophistication and class. The British Raj wanted to make the people of India into a race of brown-skinned Englishmen that would be Indian in blood, but English in taste, in morals, in intellect, and in religion. This was Victorian and Edwardian India.
'96 brought the Great Famine followed by the bubonic plague of 1897, wherein 2.5 million people died in India. These disasters marked the beginning of the decline of the British Raj. Strict and often intrusive measures were taken to subdue the plague. People were harassed, houses were broken into, hosed down, fumigated and limewashed with no concern for the sensibilities of the inhabitants. The police carried out orders with a toughness that on occasion became brutal. Complaints poured in about women being offended and money being stolen. Deaths due to famine and plague escalated at such an alarming rate in 1887 that in Bombay and Calcutta, cremations were hurriedly performed openly in the streets. Thus, the people of India became increasingly dissatisfied with their foreign rulers. Soon after, the movement for independence was born, and political activists like Bala Gangadhar Tilak, Mahatma Gandhi, Pandit Nehru, Jinnah, Bhagat Singh, Subhas Chandra Bose, Aurobindo and others took the stage. From time to time, there were demonstrations protesting British rule and occasional outbreaks of violence. These were promptly suppressed by British force that was sometimes fatal, such as the massacre at Jallianwala Bagh, where 379 men, women and children were killed, and 1,560 fell wounded. Other events in the world added to the uncertainty of the empire's future when World War I broke out in Europe between 1914 and 1918, resulting in the deaths of more than 10 million people, many of which were Indian soldiers fighting for the British. Indeed, these were troubled times. The karmic reaction of decades, even centuries, of materialism was now taking its relentless toll. In an atmosphere of expanding empires, wars, natural disasters, political calamity, and all-round spiritual void, the world was clearly lacking the leadership and example of someone who knew the real purpose of the human form of life. During the early part of the 20th century, there occurred a unique event in the spiritual history of modern India. In the remote village of Sridhar Mayapur, on the banks of the sacred Ganga in West Bengal, there resided a distinguished personality who would, in due course, do more to help raise the consciousness of human civilization than that of any other person of his time. On March 7, 1918, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakura Prabhupada, adorning the saffron robes of a mendicant, accepted the renounced order of life, Tridandi Sannyas. He then raised the clarion call of Sri Krishna Sankirtan at Sridhar Mayapur with Kartala Mridanga, that would eventually be heard in every town and village around the world. In so doing, Sarasvati Thakur brought attention to the deep spiritual teachings of Krishna consciousness. He issued a universal challenge of totalitarian war against all philosophical and theistic misconceptions that cover the true identity of the soul. In the teachings of Sarasvati Thakur, the only thing lacking in this material world is Krishna consciousness. The only real welfare work to be done is the distribution of Krishna consciousness, the prime benediction for humanity at large. The achievements of power, wealth, and fame are all temporary and lead to the perpetual suffering of the soul in the cycle of repeated birth and death. The Sankirtan movement, started by Sarasvati Thakur from Sridhar Mayapur, was the revival of the original Krishna Sankirtan movement of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the 15th century. Through his preaching, Sarasvati Thakur attracted to his mission many sincere members of the intelligentsia and social elite of Bengal. Together with his disciples, Sarasvati Thakur led a second renaissance of the Krishna consciousness movement, establishing temples, defeating opposing philosophies, recruiting thousands of converts to the doctrine of divine love, and publishing ancient and modern spiritual texts in periodicals, books, and newspapers, and distributing them throughout India and abroad. From the time of his accepting Tridandi Sannyas in 1918 until his departure from this world in 1937, his mission, known as the Gaudiya Math, flourished under his guidance. Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakura Prabhupada was born in Orissa at Jagannatha Puri on February 6, 1874, as the seventh child of Bhaktivinoda Thakura and Srimati Bhagavati Devi. Bhaktivinoda Thakura was a government official and was in charge of the Jagannath temple in Puri. In his spiritual life, Bhaktivinoda was a great pioneer of the Krishna consciousness movement. At a time when the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had all but been lost or distorted by unscrupulous persons, such as the Sakibekis, Bhaktivinoda began publishing numerous papers, journals, and books, establishing the pure teachings of Sri Chaitanya. By his personal character, he restored dignity to the Gaudiya Vaishnava community. Bhaktivinoda prayed fervently to Lord Jagannath to kindly send him someone who would be capable of preaching the message of Sri Chaitanya. Upon the birth of his seventh child, Bhaktivinoda realized after observing a series of divine events that his newborn son was indeed the answer to his prayers. Accordingly, Bhaktivinoda named his son Bimala-prasada, meaning the mercy of Lord Jagannath, or one who revealed to the world the pastimes of the Supreme Lord. His sons receiving the blessings of Lord Jagannath during the annual Rath Yatra festival, when he was only 5 months old, was noted by Bhaktivinoda as a direct confirmation of the divinity of his son. A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada shares with us the memory of this event.
When my spiritual master appeared at Jagannath Puri, he was the son of a very big government office, Bhaktivinoda Thakura. He was magistrate, and in those days the magistrate is a big officer in the government, practically next to governor. And Bhaktivinoda Thakura was in charge of the Jagannath temple. So there was Rath Yatra festival, and the car was passing in front of Bhaktivinoda Thakura's house. The car stopped before his house, and at that time Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakura, a child in the lap of his mother, the mother took the opportunity of rising on the car. He was magistrate's wife, so he had the facility. Immediately people gave her a way to go on the top of the car and place the child on the lotus feet of Jagannath, and there were many garlands. One garland fell upon him. Bhaktisiddhanta says, blessings.
Bhaktivinoda Thakura moved his family to Calcutta the same year as Sarasvati Thakura's birth. And later, in 1881, Bhaktivinoda constructed Bhakti Bhavan, the family's residence and place of bhajan. While digging the foundation for the house, Bhaktivinoda found a Kurma Shalagram Shila. He then placed 7-year-old Sarasvati Thakura in charge of the daily worship of the Shalagram, which still remains at Bhakti Bhavan. Sarasvati Thakura was indeed an exceptional personality, who always showed keen interest in spiritual life. By the age of 7, he was assisting his father in proofreading the Sajjanatoshini, a monthly spiritual journal. That same year, he received Harinam initiation with Tulsi beads and Narasingha mantra from Bhaktivinoda. As a primary student at the Sri Rampur Christian Missionary School, Sarasvati Thakura quickly mastered his general studies. Later, in 1885, while under the tutelage of Pandit Mahesh Chandra Chudamani and Pandit Sundarlal, he excelled in Sanskrit, mathematics and Vedic astrology. He was thus awarded the honorific title of Siddhanta Sarasvati, meaning one whose knowledge and scholarship are blessed by the goddess of learning. That title was to remain with him for life. In 1887, Bhaktivinoda Thakura was posted in government service at Krishnanagar. During that time, he began visiting Navadvip town. On one such visit to Navadvip, Bhaktivinoda was staying at the Rani Dharmashala when he had a vision of Yogapit, the birth site of Sri Chaitanya. One Saturday evening, Bhaktivinoda was sitting on the roof of the Dharmashala in Navadvip. Across the Ganga, in the direction of Mayapur, Bhaktivinoda saw an effulgent glow. Within that divine effulgence appeared the Adbhut Mandir, a wonderful temple surrounded by light. Bhaktivinoda was utterly amazed. The following Saturday, Bhaktivinoda went to the area of Mayapur, where at night he again had a wonderful vision of the Adbhut Mandir. He spent the next day wandering all over the area. The elderly locals told him that this was indeed the location of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's birth. They pointed out an extensive mound covered with tulsi plants as the actual site of the Lord's appearance. However, in Navadvip, the findings of Bhaktivinoda were opposed by caste brahmanas, who claimed that the birth site of Sri Chaitanya was actually Prachin Mayapur in modern Navadvip town. But according to Bhaktivinoda's research, utilizing old maps of Ganga Govinda Singh, and authentic manuscripts of the Chaitanya Bhagavat, Bhakti Ratnaka, and Navadvip Parikram Padati, he was certain that Mayapur was located on the eastern bank of the Ganga. He also discovered that the present town of Navadvip, situated on the western bank of the Ganga, was not more than 100 years old. Thus, Prachin Mayapur in modern Navadvip could not be the birth site of Sri Chaitanya.
It has got no ground because Yogopi, it is a birth place, it is true for all respect. She particularly sees it. She, after all, Mahapur was born just 529 years or so, or 20 years. And during that time, definitely there are that, how to say, all the records, maps, everything. So from the point of archaeological, from the point of history, from the point of geography, from the point of literatures, it is clearly proved without any doubt that Mahaprabhu was born in the eastern side of Ganga. And Prachin Mayapur is in the western side. Therefore, undisputed.
Wishing to confirm his vision and findings even more resoundingly, Bhaktivinoda in 1888 requested his Shiksha Guru and the head of the Gaudiya Vaishnav community, Jagannath Das Babaji, to come to the newly discovered birth site of Sri Chaitanya. The aged Babaji, who was more than 120 years old at that time, had to be carried in a basket wherever he went. However, when Jagannath Das Babaji was brought to the spot discovered by Bhaktivinoda Thakura, he became overwhelmed with ecstasy and jumped from his basket, shouting, "Eto nimai janmabhumi, eto nimai janmabhumi." This is indeed the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya. Thus, from both an empirical and spiritual point of view, the place of Sri Chaitanya's birth was ascertained. From this time on, Sarasvati Thakura began staying in Mayapur at intervals. In 1889, Bhaktivinoda built his place of bhajan, Svananda Sukhada Kunj, at Godruma Dweep on the banks of the Jalangi. Sometimes Bhaktivinoda and Sarasvati Thakura were staying at Godruma Dweep, sometimes at Krishnanagar, and sometimes in Calcutta. In 1891, at age 17, Sarasvati Thakura gathered some of his young friends in Calcutta and formed a philosophical discussion group called the August Assembly. Each member of this discussion group took a lifelong vow of celibacy, a vow that in the end, only Sarasvati Thakura himself was able to maintain. He remained a Naishtaka Brahmachari, completely celibate throughout his life. From 1892 to 1898, Sarasvati Thakura assisted Bhaktivinoda in the development of Mayapur and the propagation of Krishna consciousness. In 1895, a grand festival was held at Mayapur in which Bhaktivinoda installed deities of Sri Chaitanya and Vishnupriya. In 1896, Bhaktivinoda prepared a small Krishna-conscious publication for sending to the West, entitled Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, His Life and Precepts. The small booklet was sent to the Royal Asiatic Society in London and to several universities in the United States and Canada. Bhaktivinoda was eager to spread the teachings of Sri Chaitanya among the educated people of the West.
Bhaktivinoda Thakur could see that there is also some sincerity in the Western search for truths and answers to the mysteries of life. And he knew that there were the answers in the Vedas, in the transcendental tradition. So he surely appreciated that an effort should be made to convey this message in a language people could relate to.
News of the American Transcendentalist movement had reached India, and Bhaktivinoda dreamed of one day seeing Western scholars and philosophers come in contact with the teachings of Sri Chaitanya. When Bhaktivinoda published Sri Krishna Samhita in Sanskrit and Bengali in 1880, he had sent copies to scholars like Ralph Waldo Emerson in America and Reinhold Rost in London. Now, with the publication of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, His Life and Precepts in English, Bhaktivinoda was optimistic that the message of Mahaprabhu would soon be taken up on Western shores. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had himself predicted that the holy name of Krishna would be sung in every town and village of the world, and Bhaktivinoda was anxious to see this happen. Also, the year Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, his life and precepts, was sent to the West, another great Gaudiya Vaishnava personality was born in Calcutta, who in the latter half of the 20th century would fulfill the desires of Bhaktivinoda and Sarasvati Thakura by preaching the holy name of Krishna in every town and village around the globe. That great personality was Abhay Charan Dev, later to become known as A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Swami B.B. Bodaya Maharaj of Gopinath Gaudiya Math confirms these facts.
Actually, nowadays, if you look the root to spread the message of Mahaprabhu around the world, he is the root of these messages to spread around the world abroad. It was his desire to spread the message. First Mahaprabhu's desire, then Bhaktivinoda's desire, and Prabhupada's desire, and he was trying to spread, and his desire, by his desire, Bhaktivinoda Swami Prabhupada, going out by his power, by his grace, he spread the message around the world.
While staying in Calcutta, Sarasvati Thakur studied Sanskrit at the Calcutta Sanskrit College, and he studied Vedas under Pandit Prithividhar Sharma. During those years, Sarasvati Thakur manifested a strong tendency towards renunciation and informed his family and teachers that he had no intention of taking up householder life. In 1898, Sarasvati Thakur accompanied Bhaktivinoda on pilgrimage to Gaya, Banaras and Prayag. After returning to Swananda Sukada Kunj in Godrumadweep, Sarasvati Thakur, then 24 years old, met his spiritual master, Gorkishodas Babaji, for the first time. It was at Swananda Sukada Kunj that Sarasvati Thakur would have repeated opportunities to associate with the most elevated Vaishnavas of his time, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Jagannath Das Babaji, Vamsidas Babaji, and Gorkishodas Babaji. In late January of 1900, after repeated humble submissions, Gorkishodas Babaji happily accepted Sarasvati Thakur as his formally initiated disciple and conferred upon him Bhagavati Diksha and the name Sri Varshabhanavi Dayata Das, meaning one who is the servant of the dear most beloved of Srimati Radharani.
মানে ভক্তিবিনোদ ঠাকুরেরও ইচ্ছা ছিল যে গৌরকিশোর বাবাজি মহারাজকে উনি যে আমার নিজের ছেলে তো এই জন্য উনি একটু সংকোচ করেছিলেন যে আমার ছেলেকে তাহলে উনি নৃসিংহ মন্ত্র দিয়েছিলেন নৃসিংহ মন্ত্র হই না প্রথমে উনি দিয়েছিলেন ভক্তিবিনোদ ঠাকুর প্রভুপাদকে দিয়েছিলেন তারপরে গৌরকিশোর বাবাজি মহারাজ তো ভক্তিবিনোদ ঠাকুরের কাছে ভাগবত শুনতে আসতেন সানন্দ সুখ করবে ওপারে সবই বন্ধু তা ভক্তিবিনোদ ঠাকুর দেখলেন গৌরকিশোর বাবাজি খুব ভালো সেন্ট ভেরি গুড সেন্ট আমার ইচ্ছা যে তাহলে আমার ছেলেকে এনার কাছ থেকে দীক্ষা নিজের ছেলে তো প্রভুপাদ সরস্বতী ঠাকুর এই জন্যে নিজের ছেলে হিসাবে আর দেখলেন ইনি গুড সেন্ট আর সরস্বতী ঠাকুরেরও খুব ইচ্ছা হয়েছিল যে গৌরকিশোর বাবাজি মহারাজের কাছ থেকে নিয়ে
In 1902, Sarasvati Thakur returned to Jagannath Puri with Bhaktivinoda, where he came into conflict with the Kirtan party led by Radha Raman Charan. Radha Raman Charan had established a poetic style of Kirtan, wherein there were opposing philosophical conclusions and conflicting transcendental mellows. It was also the practice of Radha Raman Charan to imitate ecstasies and sometimes dress himself or his male followers as gopis or sakibekis. Sarasvati Thakur found Radha Raman Charan's kirtan deviations and imitations to be against the principles of Sri Chaitanya. All these deviant practices were firmly protested by Sarasvati Thakura, who preached pure devotional kirtan. In 1905, Sarasvati Thakura traveled to South India, where he met the head priest of the Ramanuja Sampradaya at Sri Purandadur. Together, they discussed the Vaishnava order of Trudandi Sannyas that had been in effect for several thousand years since the time of Vishnu Swami. It was clear to Sarasvati Thakura from their discussions that Trudandi Sannyas was an accepted part of Vaishnava Dharma, although it had been lost over time in certain parts of the country. Returning from South India, Sarasvati Thakura went to Mayapur, where he remained for 4 years and performed the Naam Vrat of chanting 300,000 names of Krishna every day.
Mahaprabhu is the only person who came into this world to give life to all people by chanting Harinam Sankirtan. Naam is the only thing by which one can get rid of all the pains of this world. Naam Kirtan, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. At Mayapur, full of jungle, not a single temple. Prabhupada used to stay in the bhajan koti, which I had to at that site, but only one room that was constructed by man. And on the top floor, in the jungle, there's no road at all. You have to walk from Hulurghat. That is, by crossing the Ganges, you have to go by foot. Nothing else. No cart. No cow cart. Later on, cow cart started. When I first went there with my father, at that time there was no cow cart. No question of bus, motor, road, electricity.
By 1914, Sarasvati Thakura had become widely recognized as a stalwart preacher of the Sankirtan movement of Sri Chaitanya. The numerous branches of Bengali pseudo-spiritualists, such as Gauranagaris, Baals, Sakibekis, Smatas, Ativadis, and Jati Gosais, cowered in fear before this great personality. The mission of Sri Chaitanya was now in good hands, and Mayapur was beginning to flourish. In a letter, Bhaktivinoda Thakura gave Sarasvati Thakura specific instructions for establishing Devi Varanashram, the divine social system based on service to Krishna, for preaching Krishna consciousness to the masses, for publishing devotional books, for serving Sridhar Mayapur, and for establishing the annual circumambulation of Navadvip Dham. Not long after giving these instructions, Bhaktivinoda Thakura concluded his earthly pastimes and attained the eternal realm of Gaurav Vrindavan. On June the 23rd, 1914, precisely at noon, Bhaktivinoda entered the pastimes of the Supreme Lord, far beyond the vision of the conditioned souls of this world. The next year, on November the 17th, 1915, Gaurkishore Das Babaji also left this mortal world for the eternal pastimes of the Supreme Lord. Sarasvati Thakura then placed his Guru Dev's body in Samadhi. Within 2 years, both the gurus of Sarasvati Thakura, Gaurkishore Das Babaji, and Bhaktivinoda Thakura had departed from this world. Sarasvati Thakura felt deep separation from his affectionate gurus and was thus thinking how he would be able to fulfill the desires of his spiritual masters. Then, one night, while contemplating the instructions of Bhaktivinoda Thakura, he saw a vision that Sri Chaitanya had arrived at Yogapith temple with all his associates amid the sound of Krishna Sankirtan. With him, the six Goswamis, Jagannatha Das Babaji, Bhaktivinoda Thakura, and Gaurkishore Das Babaji, all of whom spoke encouraging words for Sarasvati Thakura to boldly preach the message of Sri Chaitanya and assured him of all success. Soon after, Sarasvati Thakura found a piece of torn paper carried by the wind. The paper contained a verse from Chaitanya Charitamrita, wherein Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructs Sanatana Goswami. From this verse, Sarasvati Thakura derived four codes that would become the foundation of his missionary activities: to publish Krishna conscious literature, to teach the principles of devotional service, to open centers for the cultivation of Krishna consciousness, and to teach people how to perform renunciation. That same year, Kunjibihari Vidyabhushana became a disciple of Sarasvati Thakura and began assisting him in spreading Sri Chaitanya's message. Kunjibihari Vidyabhushana, later to become Bhaktivilas Tirtha Maharaj, became the head organizer and manager of all of Sarasvati Thakura's preaching efforts. From 1914 until 1918, Sarasvati Thakura gave considerable thought to the necessary steps to be taken in order to widely spread the Sankirtan movement. Having received direct intimation from both his gurus and from Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu directly, Sarasvati Thakura resolved to accept Tridandi Sannyas, the renounced order of life, on the occasion of the 432nd appearance day anniversary of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, on March the 7th, 1918. Thus, he became known as Tridandi Goswami Sri Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati. He then established his preaching headquarters nearby Yogapit at Sri Chaitanya Math, where he installed deities of Sri Sri Guru Gauranga Gandharvika Giridhar. The Bhagavad printing press was set up at Chaitanya Math, and the presses worked constantly for printing the message of Sri Chaitanya. That same year, a house was rented at Ultadanga Junction Road in Calcutta, and a flurry of preaching and Sankirtan activities began. Many educated and influential people of Calcutta, such as Jagadbandhu Datta and Sakicharan Rai, came to the Ultadanga house to hear the lectures of Sarasvati Thakura, and later became his initiated disciples. The place of preaching was called Bhaktivinoda Asana, meaning the place of the conception of Bhaktivinoda. Soon thereafter, he awarded Tridandi Sannyas to Sri Jagadish Bhakti Pradeep, a disciple of Bhaktivinoda Thakura, and conferred upon him the title Bhakti Pradeep Tirtha. Tridandi Sannyas is the lifelong vow of unconditional service to the Supreme Lord, with body, mind and words. In 1920, the deities of Sri Sri Gauravinoda Ananda were installed at Bhaktivinoda Asana in Calcutta, and the spiritual institution for the widespread propagation of the Sankirtan movement under the name Gaudiya Math officially started. In 1921, the annual Navadvip Mandal Parikram began from Yogapit, and thousands of pilgrims and devotees attended. In 1924, the first Vyasa Puja, celebrating the 50th appearance day anniversary of Sarasvati Thakura, was held at the Gaudiya Math in Calcutta. In 1925, during the Navadvip Mandal Parikram, Sarasvati Thakura and his disciples were physically attacked by an angry mob of caste-conscious Brahmins, pundits and hired thugs in Navadvip. At that time, Vinod Vihari Das, later to become Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, performed the heroic act of exchanging dress with Sarasvati Thakura and diverting the mob while Sarasvati Thakura was taken to safety. That year, the Vyasa Puja of Sarasvati Thakura was held in Cuttack in Orissa, and he was given the title Prabhupada, meaning at whose feet many masters have taken shelter. 1926 and 1927 saw the publication of the daily Bengali newspaper Nadia Prakash and the monthly English journal The Harmonist. Not a day went by, nor a moment in a day, where Sarasvati Thakura was not preaching and propagating the message of Sri Chaitanya. He gave much importance to the publication of Krishna conscious literature and called the printing press the Brihat Mridanga. Sarasvati Thakura often said that the Kartala Mridanga in Sankirtan can be heard nearby, but the printing press can be heard around the world. In the course of 18 years, from 1918 to 1937, Sarasvati Thakura published important literatures of the six Goswamis, such as Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Hari Bhakti Vilas, and Sakriya Sardipika. He published the Bhagavad-gita commentaries of Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakura and Baladev Vidyabhushana. He also published Vrindavandas Thakur's Chaitanya Bhagavat, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami's Chaitanya Charitamrita, all the works of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, the fifth chapter of Brahma Samhita, and Sri Vyasadev's Srimad Bhagavatam. Saraswati Thakur's writing and publishing was indeed monumental. During these years, Saraswati Thakur also established over 64 missionary centers in India and abroad, and installed deities of Mahaprabhu and Radha Krishna in all the main Gaudiya Maths, such as Sri Sri Gandhavika Giridhari at Chaitanya Math in Mayapur, Sri Sri Vinod Ananda at Bagbazar Math in Calcutta, Sri Sri Radha Damodar at Krishna Chaitanya Math in Vrindavan, Sri Sri Vinod Madhava at Purushottam Gaudiya Math in Jagannath Puri, Sri Sri Gopi Gopinath at Brahma Gaudiya Math in Alanath, and Sri Sri Nayanabhi Rama at Ramananda Gaudiya Math on the Godavari River. During this time, Saraswati Thakur also conferred sannyas on a total of 21 disciples and sent them out to preach the message of Sri Chaitanya. Some of his prominent sannyasi disciples were Sri Bhakti Pradeep Tirtha Maharaj, his first sannyasi disciple, Sri Bhakti Hriday Bon Maharaj, his leading preacher in Europe, Sri Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Dev Goswami Maharaj, the guardian of pure devotion, Sri Bhakti Vivek Bharati Maharaj, a great preacher of Srimad Bhagavatam, and Sri Bhakti Vichar Yajavara Maharaj, the last initiated sannyas disciple of Saraswati Thakur. After moving the deities from Ultadanga Junction Road to the newly constructed temple at Bagbazar, Saraswati Thakur opened the first theistic diorama exhibition in Mayapur during the 1930 Gaurapanima festival. The dioramas depicted the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya and the principles of devotional service. In 1932, Saraswati Thakur travelled to South India again, where he preached the Sankirtan movement of Sri Chaitanya and established the worship of Sri Chaitanya's lotus feet in several important holy places, such as Mangalagiri, the place of Lord Narasingha, and Kovur, where Sri Chaitanya met Ramananda Rai. He travelled with a few of his disciples as far south as Mysore and Uti. At Uti, he wrote the forewords to Sri Brahma Samhita and Sri Krishna Chaitanya by Professor Nishikant Sanyal. At Mysore, he was the honoured guest in the palace of the king Krishna Raj Wodeya. During his stay in Mysore, Saraswati Thakur lectured on the principles of Srimad Bhagavatam at the Maharaja's Sanskrit College and visited several of the local temples such as Nanjangud and Sri Rangapatna on the banks of the Kaveri River. Saraswati Thakur was keen to preach Krishna consciousness to Westerners. In his travels throughout India, he sometimes discussed philosophy and religion with persons like the German scholar Dr. Magnus Hirschfeld, Sir William Malcolm Haley, Governor of the United Provinces, and Professor Albert Southers from Ohio State University. Saraswati Thakur often made elaborate arrangements for Westerners to come to Mayapur to hear the sublime teachings of Sri Chaitanya. From South India, Saraswati Thakur returned to Bengal, where he laid the foundation stone at the house of Advaita Acharya in Mayapur. The Bhaktivinoda Institute, an educational foundation for the residents of Sridhar Mayapur, was also opened that same year, and many students were admitted. The first Vrajamandal Parikram began in 1932, and Saraswati Thakur and his disciples circumambulated Vrajamandala during the month of Kartik. Saraswati Thakur arrived in Vrindavan by car with many of his non-Brahmin disciples. This created quite a stir among the caste Goswamis of Vrindavan, and all the main temples closed their doors in protest. Only the Radha Raman temple opened its doors and welcomed Saraswati Thakur and his disciples. At the Radha Raman temple, Saraswati Thakur commented that he was getting the darshan of all the deities of Vrindavan in Radha Raman.
So this is the very, I want to tell that this is the very close relation with the Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati and our great grandfather Madhusudan Goswami. And they have preached together all over the India. At that time, the Arya Samajis, they were very powerful, and they want to criticize about that deity worship and our Gaudiya Vaishnava cult. They don't accept that Mahaprabhu was the incarnation of Radha and Krishna. They have said that only the Mahaprabhu was the great personality, but not the incarnation of Radha and Krishna. But our great-grandfather and Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati, they have proved with the scriptures that Mahaprabhu was the incarnation of Radha and Krishna. And they have given the challenge to Arya Samajis. And they have defeated them, and they have accepted that Mahaprabhu was the incarnation of Radha and Krishna. So, at that time that all the temples, they have allowed Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati after that he can visit all these Gaudiya Vaishnava temples and other temples. And he has visited and he has given the respect from the temples and the local Gaudiya Vaishnava sadhus.
At Radhakund, Sarasvati Thakur established a house for the residence of his gurus, Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Gaurakishordas Babaji. He said that he and his disciples should only stay there to serve the higher Vaishnavas, and that their place of residence should be at Govardhan Hill, a little distance away. Sarasvati Thakur always cautioned his disciples not to intrude upon the higher Leela of Krishna. First deserve, then desire. Do not try to go to the higher plane with your impurities. First, purify your heart with Nam Sankirtan, the holy name of Krishna. Unlike other so-called gurus and Siddha Purushas of his time, Sarasvati Thakur did not allow his disciples to discuss the details of Krishna's amorous love with the gopis, although Sarasvati Thakur did indeed have many highly qualified disciples. He was particularly disturbed if he heard that any disciple was discussing Rasleela. Sarasvati Thakur also did not allow his disciples to read such books as Gita Govinda, Ujjwala Nilamani, or Govinda Lilamrita. Sarasvati Thakur's caution was Matala Harijana Vishaya Range, Pujala Ragpata Gaurava Bange. Always worship the path of Ragamag, spontaneous devotion. Do not rush ahead. Keep yourself a little distant and below. One who transgresses these instructions will be cast down. That was the motto of Gaudiya Math.
Why people were objecting? Why they were objecting? Because he was distorting the teachings, or he was pointing out the distortion. After all, if you really want to take and put in a nutshell what he taught about Gaudiya Vaishnavism was, we should practice Gaudiya Vaishnavism without any hypocrisy. This is what he said. I'm the enemy of hypocrisy, especially when it comes in the name of Gaura. This was really what he amplified, this point. And there was a lot of it, and therefore there was a lot of objection. And then when they object, he roared louder. They used to call him, his disciples, Singha Guru, Lion Guru. Like a lion, he roared back louder. He was not about to be intimidated by any such objections. And then they would cite the philosophy and question his initiation and this and so many things. Doctrines came up in opposition to him. So many fine, detailed points, ignoring his emphasis on being the enemy of hypocrisy, an emphasis on a serving disposition, rather than just collecting information about Radha and Krishna Leela. Actually cultivating self-sacrifice. I mean, this is what this monk order was about, self-sacrifice. Send somebody who could sit happily in the dham, in the holy place, and get chapatis and rice and chant Hare Krishna. No, send them to England with nothing. Send them to America with nothing, these monks. Let them live only on their faith in Krishna. Krishna will provide. Faith in the name of Krishna. That's what my Guru Maharaj did on his order. And see what happened from that. Who has life, he said. That person can preach, can explain these things. They had life. They were giving life to Gaudiya Vaishnavism. We can embrace Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakura and live in Gaudiya Vaishnavism. Reject him and die to what it's all about, no matter how much information we may have about it, how well we can speak theoretically about it.
In 1933, Sarasvati Thakura sent his first envoys to Europe via London to preach the message of Sri Chaitanya. Bhakti Hridaya Bon Maharaj, and Bhakti Pradeep Tirtha Maharaj set sail from Bombay with the blessings of Sarasvati Thakur to preach and propagate Krishna consciousness in the West. They were armed with the blessings of the Bhagavad Sampradaya and the book Sri Krishna Chaitanya by Professor Nishikant Sanyal. In London, Sarasvati Thakur's preachers held programs at Albert Hall and met with British royalty, such as King George V and Queen Mary. They also met with the Archbishop of Canterbury and the distinguished Lord Zeppelin. Travelling to Germany, Sarasvati Thakur's preachers met with Reich Chancellor Adolf Hitler and his ministers, such as Herr Joseph Goebbels. Sri Chaitanya's teachings of divine love were preached to all these men, and to each was given a copy of the book Sri Krishna Chaitanya. Although these men were given the chance to embrace the teachings of Sri Chaitanya, they did not avail themselves the opportunity, and by the next decade, they were dragged by the power of Maya into the hell known as World War II. Meanwhile, in India, Sarasvati Thakur and his disciples preached the Sankirtan movement for the benefit of humanity at large. In August of 1933, a grand festival was held at Sri Chaitanya Math in Mayapur, and all the Gaudiya Math preachers from around India attended. In this rare silent film footage, Sarasvati Thakur is seen delivering a lecture from Srimad Bhagavatam, extolling the principles of pure devotional service. Sarasvati Thakur stressed that a life of service and sacrifice for Krishna is the root cause of spiritual advancement. To all who attended his lectures, he bestowed the blessing of Mahaprabhu and Krishna. In 1934, the construction of the Adbhut Mandir at Yogapit in Mayapur began. While digging the foundation for the temple, a deity of Adoksha Vishnu was unearthed. The eminent archaeologist Sri Ram Prasad Chanda ascertained the age of the Adoksha Vishnu deity to be that of the era of Sri Chaitanya. Thus, it was determined that the Adoksha Vishnu deity was the household deity of Jagannath Mishra and Sachimata, the parents of Sri Chaitanya, further confirming the site as the birthplace of the Supreme Lord. The next year, the Adbhut Mandir was completed due to the magnanimous contributions of Sri Sakicharan Bhakti Vijay, who bore the entire expense of the temple. The grand opening was held on Gaurapanim in 1935, and was attended by thousands of devotees and pilgrims who performed loud Krishna Sankirtan. The festival was also attended by the king, Maharaja Bir Bikram Kishore Dev Bahadur of Tripura state. The Maharaja commented that he was pleased to see the developments at Sri Chaitanya's birthplace. With the opening of the skyscraper temple at Yogapit, it was concluded by all that Sarasvati Thakur had indeed fulfilled the vision of Bhaktivinoda Thakur by building the Adbhut Mandir. Sir John Anderson, Governor of Bengal, then visited Mayapur by personal invitation and presented an official proclamation that Yogapit in Mayapur was the authentic birth site of Sri Chaitanya. News of this came as the death blow to the Sahaja and Caste Brahma communities of Navadvip. In September of 1935, Bhakti Hridayavan Maharaj returned from preaching in Europe and was greeted with a grand reception in Howrah Station in Calcutta. With Bon Maharaj were two German scholars, Baron von Kurte and Herr Ernst Schulze. In due course, Ernst Schulze fully embraced Gaudiya Vaishnavism and became Sadananda Das, an initiated disciple of Sarasvati Thakur. Sarasvati Thakur was happy upon the return of his preachers from Europe, but still remained anxious that someday strong preachers should become permanently established in Western countries. In October 1936, Sarasvati Thakur went to Jagannatha Puri, where he began to manifest the pastimes of his departure from this world. In Puri, he stayed at Chataka Parvat and preached vigorously to his disciples and visitors. During one confidential discourse, he mentioned that we will not live in this world very long, and that if we can die while continuously doing Krishna Kirtan, then our birth will have been successful. We are only carriers of the message of Sri Chaitanya. In December, Sarasvati Thakur returned to Calcutta and stayed at Bagbazar Gaudiya Math. It was here that he gave his last instructions to his disciples. Always preach the message of Sri Rupa Raghunath, the followers of Sri Chaitanya. Our only desire is to become the dust at the feet of the followers of Sri Rupa Raghunath. While staying at Bagbazar Gaudiya Math, on January 1, 1937, at 5:30 a.m., Sarasvati Thakur, who had descended to this world from the personal entourage of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, concluded his earthly pastimes and returned to the abode of the Supreme Lord. Much to the wonder of everyone, all the clocks of the mat stopped at exactly that moment. Arrangements were then made to take Sarasvati Thakur's body to Mayapur by train, where he was placed in Samadhi. Along the way, thousands of people gathered to pay their respects to this great personality who had boldly preached the message of Sri Chaitanya for the benefit of all.
A special train from Calcutta to Krishnagar was arranged, and from Bagbazar Mount we carried his holy body to Salda station, from there to the special train to Krishnagar, from there on the roof of a bus came to this and this Sarvganja Ghat, from there we crossed the Saraswati River, and then again we carried by our shoulder to the mat, and there this place of Samadhi. In the morning we came, we reached, the whole day it took to come from Calcutta, to come to Chaitanya Math. About 7-8 o'clock we reached Chaitanya Math at night. Then the digging of the grave was begun. We were engaged in that ourselves. Then early morning, of course he was pressed, and there I still remember his dignified figure of an Acharya. He sat in a very dignified position and a very, very glazing color. His complexion was fair, but after 24 hours, when he was made to sit on a asana, a dignified position of an Acharya, he was tall and fair and thin, and very soft body. Then, of course, the salt was given around, and then the salt and the earth came out. After this, he's sitting, I came out. I could not stand to cover his head. I came out, and then I again go covered. The tulasi plant was put there, and we all circumambulated with some song and some reading of Bhagavatam, Haridas Thakur. I specially requested, who was chanting the conclusion poetry in Chaitanya Charitamrita commentary made by himself. Prabhupada has his own verse in Chaitanya Charitamrita, and in the conclusion he composed a poem, very sweet and very lamenting temperament. I asked to read that poem of him, and it was read. Then Haridas Thakur Nityam and Chaitanya Charitamrita, that was read. And then circumambulation of the samadhi, the tulasi plant from that. And one gentleman requested me to chant the same Sri Rupa Manjari Pada, what 2 days before he requested me to sing, and I sang. So that song was sung by me, and then everything finished.
Rupa Manjari Pada Sehi Mara Sampada
Rupa Manjari Pada Sehi Mara Sampada
Sehi Mara Bhajana Puja
Sehi Mara Bhajana Puja
Sehi Mara Pranadhan Sehi Mara Yadhara
Sehi Mara Pranadhan Sehi Mara Yadhara
Sehi Mara Jivane Viva
Sehi Mara Jivane Viva
Rasanidhi Sehi Mara Vancha Siddhi
Sehi Mara Rasanidhi Sehi Mara Vancha Siddhi
Sehi Mara Vedero Dharam
Sehi Mara Vedero Dharam
Sehi Vrata Sehi Tap Sehi Mara Mantra Ja
Sehi Vrata Sehi Tap Sehi Mara Mantra Ja
Sehi Mara Dharam Kara
After the disappearance of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakura, his mission, the Gaudiya Math, suffered a severe setback when three of his important disciples deviated from the principles of pure devotional service. This created quite a disturbance, after which many of Sarasvati Thakura's sincere disciples, such as Bhakti Vivek Bharati Maharaj, Bhakti Pragyan Keshav Maharaj, Bhakti Daita Madhav Maharaj, Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj, Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj, Bhakti Saranga Goswami Maharaj, Bhakti Vichar Yajavara Maharaj, Bhakti Vilas Tirtha Maharaj, Sakhi Charan Prabhu, Abhay Charan De, and others rose to the occasion and strived with great endeavor to uphold the teachings of Sarasvati Thakura in principle and through their perfect behavior and personal example. During that time, many missions following the codes of the Gaudiya Math were established, and the preaching of the Sankirtan movement spread throughout India. Many Krishna conscious literatures were published, and many new temples were opened. Krishna consciousness in India was flourishing, but the prediction of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that the holy name of Krishna would be spread in every town and village around the world remained a great mystery. All that was about to change in 1959, when Abhay Charan De accepted the renounced order of life and became A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami. For several years, Bhaktivedanta Swami prepared himself for a journey that would literally affect the lives of every man, woman, and child living on this planet. In 1965, Bhaktivedanta Swami set sail on the good ship Jaladuta, bound for the United States. He carried with him a trunk of newly published volumes of Srimad Bhagavatam with commentary in English. Disembarking from the Jaladuta at New York City, Lord Krishna began to make Bhaktivedanta Swami dance, the effect of which would ignite the Sankirtan movement on a global scale. In 12 short years, Bhaktivedanta Swami, then known as Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, was responsible for millions of Krishna conscious literatures being distributed in dozens of languages around the world. Temples and places of worship were established, prasadam, the mercy of Lord Krishna, was distributed to millions, and thousands of Western men and women embraced the holy name of Krishna and the teachings of Lord Chaitanya.
Take advantage of this movement, make your life perfect, go back to home, back to Godhead.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Due to Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Hare Krishna had become a household word in Western countries. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada commented many times that his success was only due to the blessings of his spiritual master, Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakura. In the 1980s and 90s, the words of other prominent preachers of the Sankirtan movement, such as those of Bhakti Raksha Sridhar Maharaj and Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj, also became heard in the Western world. The involvement of these two great personalities in the Krishna Consciousness movement further enhanced the achievements of Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Now, in the 21st century, the disciples and grand disciples of these great spiritual masters continue the spreading of the Sankirtan movement on virtually every continent, in every country, and in every town and village of the world. Krishna consciousness is the eternal consciousness of the soul. It is not limited by race, color, or a particular society. Krishna consciousness is universal, and those who understand this are indeed fortunate. May the blessings of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakura and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakura remain with them forever.
সুজনার বুদরাদিত পাদ যুগং যুগ ধর্ম ধুরান্ধর পাত্র বরং বরদাবয়দায়ক পূজ্য পদ প্রণমামি সদা প্রভু পাদ পদম ভজনোর্জিত সর্জন সঙ্গপতি পতি সাধিত কারুণি কৈক গতি প্রতি বঞ্চিত বঞ্চকা চিন্তা পদ